The B'nai B'rith networks will have a devastating impact on the culture of the 20th century. Sigmund Freud, the founder of psychoanalysis, will be a leading member of the B'nai B'rith Lodge of Vienna, Austria, during the twilight of the Habsburg Empire. Freud later will cordially thank the members of his lodge for their support during his arduous early years in psychoanalysis. Indeed, several members of the lodge will provide the initiating cadre who, along with Freud, will found the quackery of psychoanalysis. This Freud will be a charlatan and a Kabbalist. The anti-Semitism of Freud and of B'nai B'rith as an organization of British intelligence at the expense of Jews will be perhaps most clearly documented in Freud's last major work, Moses and Monotheism. Freud's hatred for creativity and the human mind will be documented in his essay on Leonardo da Vinci, in which he will assert, on the basis of no evidence whatsoever, that Leonardo was a homosexual. Later, the Frankfurt Institute for Social Research will be founded with the program of merging Marx with Freud. One of the pillars of the Frankfurt School will be Max Horkheimer. After the Second World War, Horkheimer will be instrumental in refounding and reorganizing B'nai B'rith in Frankfurt. The Frankfurt School will provide the matrix for the youth culture and counterculture of the post-war decades, in the same way that Mazzini, the high priest of Romanticism, has used his youth cults to shape the first half of the 19th century.
So, tell me, about how long have you been feeling depressed? Laughter is a defense mechanism. Since you clearly have a problem with this, we could come back to it later. Perhaps it would be best if you wish to enter psychoanalysis with me, that I tell you a little bit about how I go about things. I'm not really a strict Freudian psychoanalyst. Almost no one is a strict Freudian these days. But the old boy does have his influence. It's amazing, you know. Sigmund Freud's scientific credibility was almost destroyed. Yet, right after World War II, his ideas became the most widely discussed ideas in America. Do you know why he became so popular? Because he said it was okay to be a pessimist. He proved that if you were unhappy, it was okay, and it wasn't your fault. And I can't help noticing that you personally don't appear very pessimistic. As a matter of fact, you look somewhat optimistic. And too much optimism is exactly how a lot of people get depressed. You know, they think that they can solve the problems of the whole world. All you have to do is to get people to act rationally. And you fail, and you just make yourself depressed. And Sigmund Freud understood that. He understood that down deep, people aren't reasonable. That's why my old psychoanalysis teacher, Erich Fromm, said back in 1970 that psychoanalysis was really the science of the irrational. Anyway, this optimism stuff is 135 years out of date. What's that poem? Ah, love, let us be true to one another, for the world, which seems to lie before us like a land of dreams, so various, so beautiful, so new, hath really neither joy, nor love, nor light, nor certitude, nor peace, nor help, for pain, and we are here as on a darkling plain, swept with confused alarms of struggle and flight, where ignorant armies clash by night. Now that is pessimism. Matthew Arnold, Dover Beach, 1859, and you know, before 1859, people generally didn't write poetry that pessimistic. That, by the way, was the same year that Charles Darwin published Origin of Species, the book that really got people to look at the human race realistically. Most people think that Darwin's book is about evolution, and it's not really. As a matter of fact, Darwin didn't even use the word evolution in the first edition. The full title of the first edition tells it all. On the Origin of Species by Means of Natural Selection, or the Preservation of Favored Races in the Struggle for Life. Darwin got people to realize that life is not progress or development, but is an endless struggle for survival. So you can't be optimistic, because how things turn out is not a question of morality. It's a question of biology, over which you and I, my friend, have very little control. Darwin's propagandist, Charles Huxley, Thomas Huxley, I think he said it best. I have the quote, just a sec. Here. I know of no study which is so utterly saddening as that of the evolution of humanity. Man emerges with the marks of his lowly origin strong upon him. He is a brute, only more intelligent than other brutes, a blind prey to impulses, a victim to endless illusions which make his mental existence a burden and fill his life with barren toil and battle. This stuff changed the world back in the 1860s and 70s. Everyone had to explain the universe in terms of Darwin. Even Hermann Helmholtz, the mechanistic physicist, told his colleagues that the struggle for existence was the highest principle of explanation, in the face of which not even the molecules and the stars in heaven are safe. And Sigmund Freud said that the two most important influences on his life were Charles Darwin and Hermann Helmholtz. He even tried to study with Huxley in London and Helmholtz in Berlin. You see, what Freud did was take the blind mechanical forces of biology described by Darwin and show that they operated in the human mind. For instance, people get the idea that they can help the whole human race, but Freud told us that this was an illusion, like religion. Freud realized that if you get the idea that you can help all humanity to survive and grow, that this idea is actually your own desire to survive and reproduce, your own individual sexual urges, channeled, what we call sublimated, into a more socially acceptable form. Look at Freud's case history of Leonardo da Vinci. Maybe the greatest combination of artist and scientist in the entire history of the human race. Do you think that Leonardo was moved by some higher purpose? No way. It's sex. It's always sex. Freud said, sex starts even before you're born. Right from the start, you are biologically impelled to explore the physical world. That's where you get your ideas, from groping around in the world of the senses. And for centuries, people thought that this erotic groping around was somehow a bad thing. But Freud helped us to understand that this was natural, that you've got these instinctual, erotic drives, these irrational little demons in your head, and you can't do that much about it. So, for most people, this eroticism becomes totally inhibited by religion or some other problem, or it gets repressed by childhood experiences and transformed into neurosis. But Freud said that the reason why Leonardo da Vinci was such a genius was that he was one of those rare individuals whose erotic drives became perfectly sublimated. According to Freud, Leonardo effectively never grew up, like Michael Jackson. For for Leonardo. Scientific and artistic investigation became the substitute for sexual activity. As Sigmund Freud said, Leonardo became a complete narcissist, the ideal homosexual type. Homosexual? No. Psychoanalysis understands that it's really not a perversion. It's just one of many ways, healthy ways, by which we all deal with our irrational drives. Anyway, Freud said that all people are naturally bisexual. Well, I can see that you are still somewhat afraid of this subject. Perhaps we can deal with this problem later on in your therapy. Under any circumstances, you have got to be realistic. It is absurd to worry about universal truths. The only universals are these mechanical forces in your brains and in your pants. And each person comes up with his or her own more or less successful way of reconciling these forces with the experience that you receive in the course of growing up. Why, the whole history of social science, from Freud and almost every psychologist, plus almost all of sociology and almost all of anthropology, is one great effort to prove that you can't judge a truth in terms of all mankind. Truth is relative to the individual. And what is more, you have to accept that your mind is not truly free. Biology means that you can never completely control these erotic little demons inside your head. So don't set your sights unrealistically high. The only thing that you can hope to discover in this world, with the help of professionals like me, is how to be well adjusted. Well, of course I can't prove it. Psychoanalysis cannot clinically prove that the unconscious, the id, dream analysis, the Oedipus complex, any important Freudian concept actually exists. Freud said that psychoanalysis was like a religion. You can't prove it, but you accept it on faith. As a matter of fact, Carl Jung once wrote a letter to Freud saying, maybe we should start acting more like a form of religion. But Freud said, this is a little bit too premature. Actually, I think that this religious aspect of psychoanalysis is what attracted the Frankfurt School to Freud in the 1930s. I should probably tell you that, like many psychoanalysts today, I came to Freud via the Frankfurt School. You know, Erich Fromm, Herbert Marcuse, Horkheimer, Adorno. This Hungarian fellow named Georg Lukács founded the Frankfurt School because he was trying to determine how to cause massive social change. Lukács was specifically interested in Bolshevism, but the technique works for other ideologies. Lukács said that you have to make people completely pessimistic. You have to make them believe that they live in a world abandoned by God, as he put it. And at the same time, the new social movement that you're trying to create has to have certain key similarities to religion, but of course without a concept of a supreme being. In fact, Lukács seriously investigated the Baal Shem cult, a Jewish Kabbalistic sect, as well as several medieval Christian heresies, in order to find what he called the messianic ideas that could be incorporated into successful Bolshevik organizing. And Freudian theory fit this bill completely. It was just like going back to the Gnostic cults of the Middle Ages. The demons were back. The evil was being generated out of your own head, and you needed a new priesthood to save you. It was the Frankfurt School's extension of Freud that was the major reason that psychoanalysis became so influential in every aspect of American life. The Frankfurt School helped us all to discover how really bad our mental health was, how we had to liberate ourselves from the authoritarian constraints that made us neurotic, that we had to resist the imposition of universal values and embrace a healthy personal hedonism. Now, As your psychoanalyst, I hate to admit it, but even though Freud had a great model for the individual mind, his social psychology was a disaster. But the Frankfurt School solved that. Freud had said that the individual identity was based on the interaction of biology, the instinctual drives embedded in man's hereditary structure, with the experiences of growing to maturity within the family. Freud thought that all people were more or less the same because the instinctual drives were the same and the family structures were more or less the same. The Frankfurt School corrected this by emphasizing that each culture, each people, each race have important differences in their psychologies because their differing family structures transmit the ideas of authority, of value, of morality in different ways. So, if you want to liberate your eros and become healthy, the most important thing to do is to find what separates one culture, one people, one race from another one. The differences don't have to be in the genes. I mean, today, very few people will admit publicly that black people are biologically different from white people. It just isn't done. But the Frankfurt School emphasized what Freud only hinted at. Cultural differences transmitted through the family are as rigid and as powerful as biological differences. And thus, they proved that black people are fundamentally different from white people because their cultures are different. And a lot of people in this country supported and sponsored the Frankfurt School because they were able to use Freud's psychoanalytic theory to demonstrate scientifically that all values must be relative. And that is why today, everybody, you, me, except for a few extremists and religious fanatics, everybody understands that universal values are really authoritarian and that the family structure has got to be changed, maybe even destroyed, to stop imposing these obsolete values on our young. Anyway, in the modern world, in the post-industrial society, we no longer need, we can no longer afford this authoritarian sense of the power over nature which the patriarchal family structure transmits. Today, the most important aspect of mental health is giving people an identity that will make them happy and erotically satisfied. And this was the great original contribution of the Frankfurt School after World War II, when they worked with several Jewish organizations to create a new identity for American Jews. The Frankfurt School said that henceforth, Jewish identity would be defined not by religious belief, not by the ideas through which Jews contributed to the rest of humanity, but by the Holocaust. Jews would be trained to see themselves primarily as victims of genocide. And this worked fantastically. Even today, Jews who think that the B'nai B'rit are a bunch of crooks still give them money because they have been trained to believe that Jews are profoundly different from everyone else and that anti-Semites are everywhere waiting to start the new Holocaust at any moment. And this Jewish identity project worked so well that we, Frankfurt School Freudians, were asked to do the same thing for black people. In the 1960s, many black people were successfully retrained to believe that what really defined their identity was how their African ancestors had been enslaved by white people. We did the same thing for women. The feminist movement used the Frankfurt School and Freudian theory to help millions of women understand, realize that their real identity is defined by male chauvinism. You see how successful we have been. Today, it's everywhere. We teach it in the schools. It's called multiculturalism. Everyone gets an identity based on who raped who. Thank you. The Latin Americans understand that the most important thing is to get back at the Spanish colonialists. The Native Americans understand that the most important thing is to get back at the whites. Everyone separated from everyone else. Fear, hatred, revenge, sure, we give them that. But we give them an identity. And they are happy. But we've spent too much time talking about what I think. We should be talking more about what you're thinking, but I see that our time is up. I can fit you in next week. Tuesday? The short session is usually $75. You can pay as you leave.